Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Welcome to the session on the course Therapeutic Nutrition. This is the second module, that is Etiology, Clinical Features and Nutritional Management of Infections and Fevers. In this lecture, we shall be studying about Nutritional Management of Fever, and this is the part one. I am Dr. Jaspreet Kaur, presently working as Assistant Professor in Government College for Girls, Ludhiana, Punjab, affiliated to Punjab University, Chandigarh. And this project is funded by DTH Swayam Prabha, MHRD, New Delhi. In the last lecture, we studied about what are infections, and then we studied what are the predisposing factors of infections. Then we studied what is the relationship of nutrition along with the infection, and then we studied some key nutrients which are important during infections, and lastly we studied about the nutritional management once you get infection. In this lecture, we shall be studying about definition of fever, types of fever, and then we will see what is the effect of fever on the nutritional status, and lastly we will study about general principles of nutrition care during fever. Fever is also known as hypothermia, pyrexia, or elevated temperature. It describes a body temperature that is higher than the normal. Fever can affect all of us, and a short-term increase in the body temperature can really help our body to fight off the infections. But severe fever can be a symptom of some serious condition that requires immediate medical attention. Fevers, they are very common symptom associated with most of the infections. So in this lecture, we will discuss about fevers. The hypothalamus in our brain is an amazing organ performing many important tasks. An important function of this thermoregulatory center is to maintain our body temperature throughout all the seasons. We can correlate this thermoregulatory center with the thermostat, which we see in our electric appliances, for example, AC, your refrigerator, then electric press, ovens. The thermostat maintains the temperature at a certain level. How does our body changes the set temperature? Why is the temperature changes? What happens when the temperature changes? Let us find all these answers. Fever, it is not a disease, but a symptom of infection. It is a part of body's defense mechanism to fight infection. As we know, the pathogens, they grow best at the body temperature. The body raises the temperature to create an environment which is unconducive for the growth of pathogens. So, fever, it is a state of body in which there is elevation of temperature above 98.4 degrees Fahrenheit, and it results from imbalance between the heat produced in the body and heat eliminated in the body. Now, this fever can be in response to infection, inflammation, or any unknown cause. Now we know Fever is an imbalance between the heat eliminated by the body and the heat produced by the body. It can be caused by two factors. First one is endogenous factors, which are internal factors, and the second one is exogenous factor, that is external factors. Endogenous factors could be antigen-antibody reactions, malignancy, or graft rejection. Whereas exogenous factors could be bacteria, it could be fungus, or it could be virus. Now, let us study the mechanism of development of fever. When any external agent like bacteria, virus, or fungi that infects our body, it causes activation of phagocytes in the bone marrow, which in turn cause release of a pyrogen that is known as fever-inducing hormone. This endogenous pyrogen, it causes synthesis of prostaglandins, which are hormone-like substances. Now, these hormone-like substances, they go to our hypothalamus, that is the thermostat of our body, to reset the body temperature higher than the normal. And we call it fever. That is what we see through a thermometer. Let us see what are the metabolic changes happening with fever. A catabolic response occurs with all the infections, even in subclinical conditions, in the absence of fever. For each degree Fahrenheit rise in the temperature, there will be 7% increase in basal metabolic rate. That pertains to 13% of rise in if the temperature increases by 1 degree centigrade. Basal metabolic rate is the rate at which our body is carrying out all the involuntary activities of our body. For example, our heart is working, our kidneys, they are working, our digestive system is working. So that is increased. And as a result, the body stores, they will start getting depleted. For example, the glycogen reserves will be depleted, and infections, they stimulate interleukin 1, which is released from the leukocytes whenever there are endocrine changes. And there will be mobilization of amino acids from the skeletal muscles, resulting in depletion of body protein from the muscles. These amino acids, they are used for gluconeogenesis, and nitrogen is excreted through the unit. So this whole thing that puts a lot of burden on the body. That is, there will be additional burden on the kidneys to get rid of catabolic byproducts and loss of body fluids that will occur through the sweat, through the urine, and this whole process increases the energy expenditure by body, and one feels very weak and frail. The impact of fever on nutritional status is tremendous. And it will depend upon the type of fever, that means which part of the body it is affecting, and then severity of the infection, how strong the pathogen is, and duration of the fever, whether it is short term or acute or intermittent or long term fever. And then lastly, what is the nutritional status of the person before the infection? We have already studied in the last lecture that due to infection, there will be decreased level of micronutrients and increased interleukin. They hamper the appetite, and there will be vomiting, abdominal pains, gastrointestinal disorders, sore throat or mouth, such as in HIV cases. And then there could be depression or mental tension, which will lower the appetite. And secondly, the body is not able to absorb the nutrients efficiently. There will be a bad effect of infection or the surrounding interleukins, which will be coupled by reduced intake, which increases the requirement of the nutrients. And there are also drug interaction with the nutrients, as both affect the normal mechanism of each other. Now let us see what are the different types of fevers. Based on the duration of fevers, we can classify them into three categories, that is acute, chronic, and intermittent fevers. Acute fevers, they are fevers of short duration, but body temperature may rise even above 104 degrees Fahrenheit. Some fevers, they are associated with infections. For example, pneumonia, influenza, chickenpox, tonsillitis, or typhoid. Second type is intermittent fever. It is a pattern of fever in which there is an interval when temperature is elevated for several hours, followed by an interval when temperature backs to normal. This type of fever usually occurs during the course of an infectious disease such as malaria. The next type of fever is chronic fever. These fevers are the fevers where the onset is slow and gradual, and severity is low, and they are fevers of longer duration. Here the temperature may be low, but it contributes for much longer time and lot of protein breakdown and catabolism that sets in. The example of this type of fever are tuberculosis and AIDS, that is acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. So let us see what are the basics of nutrition care during all types of fevers. It will be first of all based on the basal metabolic rate. For example, we have already studied that the BMR that goes very high with the high fever. And secondly, we will see what is the duration of the fever. Is it acute or it is chronic, where the body needs some special kind of nutrition care? For example, is it the initial phase when there is no tolerance of the food items, and hence we have to adjust the diet accordingly? And then we have to see what is the affected part of the body. For example, when the gut is infected in some gastrointestinal tract infection or a fever associated where the intestines, they are affected, we have to choose the food which is easy to digest and absorption is also ensured. Then we will see what are the important nutrients which are lost in relation to the specific fever. Here we know that the sodium and potassium, they are lost with the sweat and the urine, especially when the fever is very high. In TB, massive protein losses, they occur. And then we have to see what is the previous nutritional status of a person. If we consider that, it is rather helpful for a patient so that we can give him proper diet in right time. And then lastly, we look for the hydration. If hydration is ensured, it gives lot of benefit because the utilization of nutrients is enhanced when the patient is properly hydrated. So in all types of fever, the basic principle is to provide high protein, high energy, nutrient dense diet. Here we will see that extra care should be taken to ensure that the diet is easy to digest, and we also recommend that frequent small meals they are to be given so that ample rest is ensured to the affected part of the body, and at times the adequate rest is needed by the full body so that the patient can recover faster. The feeding pattern should be like that. We start from liquid diet, and then we see when the tolerance improves, we shift to soft diet, followed by bland diet, and till the time the person is able to take normal nutritious diet. So let us summarize. In this lecture, we studied what is the definition of fever. We studied that it is a state of body in which there is elevation of temperature above the normal, that is 98.4 degree Fahrenheit, and it results from an imbalance between the heat produced in the body and the heat eliminated from the body. Then we studied about what are the metabolic changes that happens with the fever, and their impact on the nutritional status was also covered. After that, we saw what are the different types of fevers. They are acute, they are chronic, they are intermittent, and their duration also differs. And then we learned about the principle of diet therapy for all types of fevers, and then we also discussed that what should be the feeding pattern. In the next lecture, we shall study about various types of fevers and their dietary management in detail. Thank you.